So, hello everyone. Let's get started with today's lecture. So today we will continue our discussion of generative modeling. Just to bring everyone up to speed again. So we've discussed these two major families of approaches towards predictive modeling, right? We've discussed discriminative modeling, which to a large extent can be viewed as estimating a conditional distribution, say in the context of supervised learning, a conditional distribution over the label y given the inputs x. And on the other side, an approach that would actually try to model the entire data, right? Would try to model a joint distribution between the labels y and the inputs x, and then from that joint distribution derive the conditional distribution. Right? And so we've seen a standard way of approaching this generative modeling idea, right? So and one way to do it is to start with a prior distribution of our labels. For classification, this might be a Bernoulli distribution in the binary case, or a categorical distribution for multi-class. And then we model how each of our classes looks like. Right? We have a conditional distribution over the inputs given our labels y. Right? And once we have these components, we can apply Bayes' rule to get a posterior distribution over our labels y given our inputs x, which we can then make use for predictions. So that's the general idea. We also discussed what can be benefits of these generative approaches, and in particular, since they, in some sense, capture strictly more information, right? They capture the marginal distribution over the x's, that can provide very useful information, for example, for the detecting outliers and these things. And we'll discuss some more of these applications later. Okay, and so in particular, now if you want to apply this approach, we'll have to make some modeling assumptions, right? In this case, primarily, we have to model our data, right? We'll have to model our inputs given the labels, so P of x given y. And what we had discussed in last lecture is basically a Gaussian model, right? We've discussed settings where we somehow model our input features, xi, as distributed according to a Gaussian distribution, which has different sets of parameters for each of our labels y, right? And now we can make different structural assumptions about this Gaussian distribution, right? What we actually started with was this Gaussian naive Bayes model, which basically just treats each feature as conditionally independent, right? Independent given the label, right? And in this case, you basically need to specify for each xi a Gaussian distribution, which means a scalar mean, which depends on the feature dimension I, right, and the particular class label y, and a variance, right? So these are parameters that we can try to estimate, for example, using maximum likelihood estimation. And once we've estimated the parameters, we can apply Bayes' rule, which will give us the decision rule, right? We can compute our conditional distribution of the labels given the inputs. Okay, and then we discussed what are some of the issues with this naive Bayes model. So what's nice about it is very simple, right? You can do this estimation closed form. It's very compact, right? You just need linearly many parameters with respect to these dimensions and so on, right? But of course, this independence assumption that we're making has strong consequences, right? And what this concretely leads to, and we worked through last lecture, is the fact that we often get overconfident predictions if this independence assumption is not satisfied, right? So it basically treats the feature dimensions as independent. If they're not, then we overcount, right? We might count the same, say, duplicated or almost duplicated input feature twice in some sense, right? And since we multiply, that can have an exponential effect on our class probabilities, right? That's what we've worked through in the last lecture, right? And of course, one way to fix this is to use a more complex model. So instead of modeling each feature dimension independently of each other, each with a little Gaussian, right? We can have one big Gaussian that correlates and captures dependencies between all these features, right? And that gives us Gaussian-based classifiers, right? Dropping the naive part, right? So because now we can capture arbitrary dependencies. You still make the assumption that the data is Gaussian, right? Which may or may not be a good assumption about our data. But at least we drop this independence assumption across dimensions. And estimation works in the same way, right? It's just a little bit more complicated, right? So the mean is the same. The difference is just the covariance matrix, right? Now we get covariances between the features that capture the dependencies. Okay, and so also what we worked at is we looked at various different special cases of these models, right? This is this Venn diagram that we built up in the last lecture, right? If you talk about our Gaussian-based classifiers, we looked at these special cases, the naive base, which is just a special case of the general Gaussian, but with diagonal covariance matrices, right? And then we talked about Fisher's LDA, which is also a special case of Gaussian-based classifiers that has some nice connections to principal component analysis as well. And there, we don't constrain the covariance matrices in their form, but we constrain them to be equal across classes. And that leads to linear decision boundaries, as we had seen and worked out. Okay, and then we also saw some nice connections to logistic regression, and saw that these models actually coincide, so Fisher's LDA agrees, for example, with logistic regression if the modeling assumptions are really met. Of course, in practice, that'll almost never be the case, but that's a nice connection. Okay, and so here, just to discuss some of the benefits, so at the end, what we had at last lecture, right? So if you, for example, want to contrast Fisher's LDA and logistic regression, right? In the former, we do have a generative model. It means we can make some statements about P of X, right? We get a marginal distribution over the inputs, and we can use this, for example, to do anomaly detection, outlier detection, to see if we have unusual inputs X. But of course, it makes this normal assumption, right? The Gaussian assumption about the data, which may not be satisfied. And in fact, in practice, what one often sees is that these sort of models are not very robust against non-Gaussianity of the inputs. Okay, and so logistic regression, in contrast, gives you this discriminative model, so it only makes a statement about P of Y given X, doesn't make any statement about P of X, which is bad on one side, right? You can't say anything about whether you've encountered an unusual X. That was this whole motivation of why to look at these generative models. On the other hand, it's also good because you don't need to make any modeling assumptions about the X, right? It doesn't matter whether the X's are correlated or not in any way, right? So the only assumption we're making is that the labels have independent noise, independent label noise. But otherwise, we make no assumptions whatsoever about the X's. And that can often lead to a much more robust model. So if you purely care about classification, about P of Y given X, typically logistic regression is going to do a lot better than fitting a, say, Gaussian-based classifier and then computing the conditional distribution. Okay, and so we had this discussion also about naive-based versus general Gaussian-based classifiers, right? And discussed the naive-base has the advantage that you have this nice linear parameterization. So if we deal with high-dimensional models, then we only, this is more tractable, right? We only have basically two parameters per dimension. But of course, it can lead to these overconfident predictions as we had worked out, right? And for the general case, we can detect whether features are dependent on each other and avoid this overconfidence. Then, of course, the model is more complex, both statistically, so there's more parameters to estimate, and also computationally, right? Now we have to work with covariance matrices, have to compute the inverses, right, or Cholesky decompositions, and so on, right? So in large dimensional settings, if D is, say, in the thousands or tens of thousands or even more, and we've seen that this can often be the case, then this might not take us far enough, okay? And of course, these are two extremes, right? And there's a whole spectrum of models in between, right? And one can go, can place a lot more assumptions about how data might look like, right? And so one line that I want to explore here a bit is, what if you don't have Gaussian distributions, right? What if, for example, if you have discrete variables? But this is meant to give you a bit of a sense, right, that if you go this generative modeling route, you now have to really carefully think about how do you actually model the data. Okay, and if you do a good job in modeling the data, these models can be very powerful. But if you get it wrong, it can also be problematic. Okay, so the starting point here is, right, so far we've discussed the setting where X might be some vector in the d-dimensional reals, right, so a vector of numbers. right, and general real numbers, right? And we've modeled them with a Gaussian distribution, right? Nice unimodal distribution, symmetric around the mean, etc. Okay, and this might not be a very good model for our data, right? And especially if you talk about discrete distributions, for example, just blindly applying a Gaussian is maybe not the right idea, right? So if you have explicitly discrete attributes, like demographic attributes, like gender, nationality, etc., then we might not want to model these with a Gaussian. Okay? But now, right, if you take this generative viewpoint, it's easy to just swap one type of distribution with a different, right, with a different distribution, right? We could say that instead of modeling each of our features as a Gaussian distribution, we model them with a distribution that better suits our data. Say, in the case of binary attributes, maybe a Bernoulli distribution, right? In the case of discrete categorical variables, maybe with the categorical variable, et cetera. Right? So let's just go through this example in the context of discrete models, right? Categorical variables, right? So now, basically, let's look at the setting where each of our variables, xi, essentially takes one out of c possible discrete labels, one through c, right? Then one natural modeling assumption we could make is that we have a categorical distribution, right? So basically, we just assign each outcome a given probability, and this probability depends on both the feature index I and depends on the class label y, right? So this is, in principle, completely general if you want to parameterize discrete distributions, right? And of course, we have to make sure that this parameterization, right, which is given now in terms of these parameters theta, the superscript I indexes the feature dimension, the subscript c given y refers to the fact that we talk about the probability of observing label c given class label y, right? Now, these numbers have to satisfy certain conditions, right, given the fact that we do talk about distributions, right? In particular, they all need to be non-negative in sum to one, right? So for all I, it must hold that, for all I, C, and Y, it must, let me actually just call this, okay, sorry, this is C, let's call this J. Call this X. Okay. It must hold that theta, because C was the number of classes, so theta X given Y must be non-negative, and then of course they need to sum to one, right? So for all I and for all Y, if you sum over all possible states X from one to C, then these numbers must sum to one. Right, so this specifies a categorical distribution. Okay, and again, now this attaches a likelihood for this particular realization of this ith feature, and we can look at its likelihood, right, and do maximum likelihood estimation. Right, and that is very simple. So I'm not deriving the formula for the maximum likelihood estimate, but it's given in closed form. Right, it's very similar to what we had talked about earlier, right? Even for the Gaussian-based classifiers, we still started with a categorical distribution over our labels, right? So we had, c different a bunch of different class labels, right? And we just estimated the relative frequency of those, right? And now we can do exactly the same thing in order to estimate conditional probabilities. Right? So that's the only difference, right? Now we need to estimate a conditional distribution conditional on each y. Right? But this just means that we essentially have to look at the relative frequency where we only consider cases that agree with the given class label. Right? And only to write this is to basically say that in order to get the maximum likelihood estimate for this parameter theta I sub c given y, we just look at how many cases, how many training examples had label C for feature I, and at the same time had class label Y, divided by the total number of cases of class label Y. right? It's just the relative frequency. Okay, and this in fact does give the maximum likelihood estimate. I'm not going to prove this here, that's a pretty simple derivation. Right, so instead of just counting, right, first to get the maximum likelihood estimate for the class label, you would just look at the frequencies of each of the classes. Here we have to look per class, what's the frequency of each of these discrete feature realizations. Okay, so that's very straightforward. And that gives us the categorical naive Bayes classifier. Right, so a very simple modification from the Gaussian naive Bayes classifier. The only thing we did is we swapped the likelihood. Right, so for the ith feature xi, we didn't model it with the Gaussian, but now we are modeling it with the categorical distribution. Right, and this is a different parameterization that we can estimate. Right, so this is the categorical naive Bayes classifier. And again, for learning, all we need to do is to do a maximum likelihood estimation for each of our feature likelihood functions, p of xi given our class label y. And then for prediction, we just apply Bayes' rule, the same way as we did for the Gaussian. The only difference is that now this is now a categorical likelihood. Right, it's not instead of a Gaussian. Right, that's really the only difference. Right, so concretely, if you were to do this, you would do the argmax over y prime of the log of the prior, right? And the prior the prior probability attached to y prime as estimated is just p sub y hat, right? That's the log prior. And now we sum the log likelihood, right? Sum over I equals 1 through D. We sum over all feature dimensions. And now, what is the log likelihood? Well, it's basically just given by these thetas here, right, that we've estimated. So we need to put log. And then what do we do? Well, we look at theta I for the ith feature. And now here, the observation is xi given y prime. Right, that's the number that we can look up and just put in here. Okay, and so this gives us now the, so now applying this rule, we'll get the most likely class label. Okay, so very straightforward generalization. And of course, now we can ask, well, so we started discussing the Gaussian naive Bayes classifier. Right, and then we said, well, one problem with the naive part is, right, that we make this independence assumption. Right, we can't deal well with dependent features. Okay? Now, you might be worried about exactly the same thing, right? Now we're just repeating possibly the same problem here, right? So instead of looking at the Gaussian distribution for each feature xi, you now have a categorical variable for each feature xi, but we still model them as independent, right? You set the probability of all these x's here, right, it's just the product. So you multiply all these features, right, assuming all these features are independent given our class label y. Right, and again, we can go through the same exercise that we've done last lecture to, for example, work through the example where we have duplicated features. Right, remember that broke the case with the Gaussian-based classifier, right, where we just took one feature, just duplicated it, right, so perfectly dependent, but used the model that treated them as not dependent, right? And this led us to exponentially overcount, right, the probability of our label, right? And here you can see that exactly the same thing is going to happen, right? And so now, of course, the question is, how can we fix this? Right? How can we fix this? What we did for the Gaussian is we said, well, let's just drop the dependence assumption. Let's just not make any independence assumption, right? We'll just assume the data is Gaussian, right? But other than that, we're not going to make any assumption. Okay? Now, we could do the same thing here, right? Now, we could just say, well, let's look at an arbitrary distribution over feature vectors, right, x1 through xd, given our class label. Anyone see any problems, potential problems? Why is this different now here if you talk about, say, discrete variables than Gaussian variables? Any potential issues? So for a Gaussian distribution, right, we can always specify it in some sense compactly, right? We just need a mean vector and a covariance matrix. Any Gaussian distribution is fully specified this way, right? So with at most d squared parameters, right, or d squared plus whatever, right? Order d squared parameters, we can specify a Gaussian distribution with arbitrary dependencies otherwise. Right? How many parameters do we need in order to specify a distribution over discrete random vectors? Right? So what does this mean concretely? Well, so we assume now our data is given by a bunch of vectors, right? So each data point xi is a vector where xi consists of d features. Say, let's just look at the binary case, right? The simplest case, Bernoulli features. Right? So xi is just the binary vector, 0, 1, 0, 0, 1, etc. Right? Now, if we don't want to model this independence across features, what would we have to do? Well, we'd have to specify the probability of any such binary vector. Now, how many such binary vectors are there? Well, a lot of them, right? So the number of binary vectors that we have to attach a probability to grows exponential in D. Right? That's really the problem here. Right? So in the Gaussian case, this is always a compact parameterization, right? These square parameters are going to be enough. But for arbitrary discrete distributions, we'd need exponentially many parameters. Right? For each y and each possible configuration of the x vector, we'd have to specify how likely is that vector. Right? And so that's an exponential number of parameters, and that obviously is a problem, right? So a problem computationally, right? So you have to store all this somehow, right? And it's also the perfect recipe to overfit, right? If you just have essentially attach each possible way of how the data could look like a separate probability and try to estimate them completely independently of each other, good luck, right? It's never going to work. Okay? Right, so because, just spell this out here, need to specify, specify probability of each assignment. Right, something like, here we have our class label y, and then we have x1, x2, all the way up to xd, right? It's a table, and now we want to say what is our parameter, right? How likely is this given configuration given y? Okay? And now here, right? So if they're all binary, right? So this might look something like, right? And so there's exponentially many of these. Right, so in general, this is far too many parameters to estimate, nor store and work with, etc. Okay, and so now the question is, how can we fix this, right? And turns out there's all sorts of ways of fixing this, right? So instead of allowing arbitrary discrete dependencies, you can now be a bit more careful about what kind of dependencies you would like to capture. And there's a lot of work on more sophisticated probabilistic models that capture dependencies between these variables in a structured way that avoid this exponential blow-up in terms of the number of parameters you need, and often also avoid the computational blow-up of, say, computing the likelihood under this model. Okay, and so this is, for example, one topic that's discussed in the probabilistic AI course in the master's program. Okay, but it's just sort of one pointer here, right, that if you go away from nice simple distributions like Gaussian distributions, right, and go to other more complex distributions, say over combinatorial discrete objects, etc., right, things get a lot more complicated. And obviously, right, also if you talk about continuous distributions, right, again, the Gaussian assumption is a very simple assumption, right? It's basically, right, the bell curve, right? perfectly symmetric around the mean, right? And so on, right? And this may not be the right assumption. And of course, again, you could try to, even for continuous distributions, plug in more complex distributions than a Gaussian. And if you do this using this naive Bayes assumption, right, treating each of the variables independently, often that's not a problem. Now you can plug in the different Gaussian likelihoods for each of these variables. But in general, specifying a multivariate distribution, a distribution over arbitrary data vectors, is really complicated. Okay, and so there's a lot of work and probabilistic modeling that plays an important role here if you want to go this generative modeling route, and that's what I wanted to point out to you. Okay, good. Now, just continuing a bit, right? So what if we have both, right? What if we, say, have both discrete and Gaussian features, Gaussian observations? Right? So that might often be the case, right? For many data sets, maybe you have a mix of discrete attributes and continuous attributes. That's not really a problem, right? Now we can sort of think about how to model such data sets, right? So if you want to stick with this naive Bayes assumption, for example, this independence assumption, we could just use a different likelihood function for each of our feature dimensions, right? For the discrete variables, we might use a categorical likelihood. And for the Gaussian variables, maybe use a Gaussian likelihood. Right? And just mix and match, right? And be more specific about how we now just model the distribution of our data. Right? So, for example, AG, X1 through 10. Are discrete, so we could model P of xi given y as a categorical distribution of xi given y and some parameters, right? And so this is, okay. One less I less than 10, might do this, right? And say x11 to 20 is Gaussian, right? Model those as P of xi given y, say as a normal distribution, right? And then, of course, we can mix, right? We could say, let's use the naive assumption for the discrete part, and let's not use, right, arbitrary correlated Gaussian for the continuous part, right? And assume that the discrete and the continuous part are conditionally independent, right? So you could then maybe say, what is the probability of x1 to 20 given y is just product of I equals 1 through 10 of this categorical distribution, xi given y and theta. And then you multiply I equals 11 to 20 of the Gaussian distribution. Right? I mean, this is just a simple example here, right? But this says, so if you want to go this generative modeling route, you have to be a lot more careful about how you actually describe and model the data. And if you do this well, this can be very powerful. If not, it can be problematic. Okay, good. Now, different topic. And so what you said is basically, you've discussed Gaussian naive Bayes, right? And general Gaussian Bayes classifiers, categorical, naive Bayes classifiers, etc., right? And the route that we went is, let's do parameter estimation and then apply Bayes' rule to get our conditional distributions, right? And for parameter estimation, we said, well, let's do maximum likelihood estimation. But you've already seen many times throughout this course that maximum likelihood estimation can be problematic, right? In particular, maximum likelihood estimation, if you use a rich enough model family, is very much prone to overfitting. right? So remember, the starting point of this investigation was the second lecture, right? When we talked about fitting polynomials, and basically these squares of fitting of polynomials was maximum likelihood estimation, right? And the way that we avoided overfitting was to regularize, right? And a few lectures ago, we've seen that you can fuel regularization through this lens of probabilistic modeling by basically interpreting a regularizer as a prior, right? So we can ask, can we do the same thing here, right? How would we do regularization in this sort of framework? And it's basically exactly the same way, right? We can now essentially make use of everything we've discussed before and just plug in the right kind of prior distribution. Okay? And so let's just work through this. In particular, we already discussed something like, right, for Gaussian distribution, one natural kind of prior is the Gaussian distribution, right? That led us to look at rich regression and these things, right? But we just discussed discrete data, right? So let's go this regularization approach, but sort of think about discrete data, right? So let's take concretely this, the categorical naive Bayes example, right? And so that means we, in the end, have to estimate categorical distributions, right? Frequencies of certain types of observations, right? And what we've seen is if you want to do maximum likelihood estimation for these types of models, then we get the closed form maximum likelihood solution simply by looking at empirical frequencies. Right? So if I flip a coin, I want to estimate, get the maximum likelihood estimate for the probability of heads, right? Then I get it by looking at just the number of heads that I see divided by the total number of times I flip the coin. Right, that's what we had used. Now, what if I flip the coin only once? Right? So what if I flip the coin only once and say it comes up heads? Then the empirical frequency is 100%. Right? Came up heads once, divided by 1 is 1. Right? And so basically, if I were to get my parameter estimate using maximum likelihood estimation from few examples, few in comparison to the number of model parameters, then I can overfit. Right? That's sort of a simple example of overfitting. Right? Say, suppose, I just spell this out, suppose our data set, right, just consists of one single coin flip. Right? Then theta hat is 1 divided by 1 is 1. Okay? And so one problem is, for example, this model would say, well, the likelihood of ever observing tails is 0. Right? If you talk about log likelihoods, right, you get logs of zeros, and I mean, everything will not work. Okay. So now, how could you fix this? Well, if we sort of think about regularization as Bayesian modeling, right, as putting a prior on certain parameters, then that's what we could do, right? We could say, well, what if we start with some prior assumption about our model parameters? And what are our model parameters here? Well, if you think about the coin flip, right, then there's one parameter, and that's the bias of the coin, right? It's the probability of observing heads in that coin flip. So it means if you want to take this viewpoint and think about regularization, what you might want to do is you want to specify a prior over these biases, right, over these parameters theta. Okay? So suppose we have such a prior distribution, right, then we can apply Bayes' rule, right? We'll just take our prior, we multiply it with our likelihood, right? That's what we had before. Okay, but then, of course, we have to renormalize. And this is just the normalization constant that makes sure that this whole thing integrates to 1, right? So they get a valid distribution over over theta, right? So that's an integral basically over over all of this, right? So over p theta p y 1 through n given theta d theta. Okay, so this is just Bayes' rule. And now, of course, the question is, when can we do this? Okay, and so now we'd have to look a bit more what kind of prior distributions we can effectively work with. So in principle, you could, I mean, use any prior distribution here, right, and just calculate that integral. But of course, computing that integral can be very difficult, right? Might not have a closed form solution, right? Might be really intractable to compute. Okay, so what's done typically in practice is to pick some sort of simple prior distributions that allow computing this integral actually efficiently. Okay, and so it turns out that for the special case of coin flips, so the probability of heads, the one very commonly used prior distribution is the beta prior, and its probability density function is given on this slide here. Okay, so this here is a probability density function over theta, right? Theta ranging from 0 to 1. And it has two parameters, alpha plus and alpha minus. I'm just going to give you some plots here. And these values, alpha plus and alpha minus, these are will be the regularization parameters, right? Or hyperparameters, parameters of that prior. And now, depending on what kind of parameters we pick, we get different shapes for this distribution. So if you plug in alpha plus equals alpha minus equals 1, and look at the resulting formula, what happens? So this first one is just the normalization constant, right? 1 over b of, right? This is just a function that makes sure things normalize to 1. And here now, we have theta raised to the alpha plus minus 1. But if alpha plus is 1, then this is just theta raised to 0. It's just 1 constant, right? Does not depend on theta. And the same thing here as well, right? So if alpha minus is 1, then that exponent here is 0, and the whole thing is just constant, right? So it means that if we use these hyperparameters alpha plus and alpha minus equals 1, this is just a uniform prior distribution over over theta, right? The uniform distribution. And so this basically says, a priori, I believe that each of the biases of my coin is equally likely. Okay, and of course you can look at what happens if you use different values for alpha plus and alpha minus. And so here's alpha plus being 2 and alpha minus being 3, 20, 30. Okay, so you can see that as these numbers increase, this distribution gets more and more peaked, gets sharper and sharper. And if these numbers are less than 1, if they converge to 0, then this distribution is actually peaked at 0 and 1. Okay, so basically if you plug in hyperparameters alpha plus and alpha minus that are less than 1, right, or close to 0, it's basically saying, like, I believe that a priori, having seen anything, I believe that the bias should either be all tails or all heads, right? So the limit of this distribution is actually just a mixture of Dirac delta distributions, right? So it just have a point mass at 0 and a point mass at 1, each weighted a half, right? So that's basically this U just peaked as much as possible. Okay, and so so let's see what happens here, right? So this so first observation, right? So this is a relatively flexible class of prior distributions that we could use, right, for this bias parameter theta of this coin flip. And what we said on the previous slide here, right, is we want a prior distribution that we can actually work with, right? So that this we can apply Bayes' rule. So let's apply Bayes' rule. And in particular, let's assume we observe data D with n plus observations of y equals plus 1 and n minus times y equals minus 1, right? So essentially we throw the coin n plus plus n minus times, right? And n plus times it came up heads and n minus times it came up tails. All right, that's our data. And we start with this beta prior, and now we want to compute base rule, right? So let's compute the probability of theta given our data, right? So what is this? Well, this is up to normalization, right? This integral that we had is basically the prior times the likelihood, right? So now let's plug in what is the prior and what's the likelihood, right? So basically what we get is, and let me only take the parts that actually where theta actually appears, right? So I have some normalizer. It's now a different normalizer, set prime. Alpha plus minus 1 times 1 minus theta alpha minus minus 1. So that comes from the prior. And now I have my likelihood, right? And I flip the coin once and it comes up heads. Then what we do is we multiply with theta. So n times we multiply with theta. And every time the coin comes up tails, we multiply with 1 minus theta. Right? Because we model the probability that the coin comes up heads. Right? So we get times theta raised to the n plus times 1 minus theta raised to the n minus. Sorry, n minus. Okay? And this here does not depend on theta and it's just a normalizer. Okay, but what is this? Well, I mean, essentially the prior and the likelihood look the same, right? So we can just collect terms. So we'll just get 1 over set prime of theta raised to the alpha plus plus n plus minus 1 times 1 minus theta raised to the alpha minus plus n minus minus 1, right? And now this looks exactly like this prior distribution. Right, and it turns out this is exactly a beta distribution. And the only change is that the parameters get updated. So alpha plus gets incremented by n plus, and alpha minus gets incremented by n minus. So what does this mean? Well, so we basically have seen that if you start with a beta prior, and we observe a Bernoulli likelihood, right? Actually, binomial likelihood. We observe multiple outcomes of heads or tails, then the posterior distribution is still a beta distribution. And the only change is that the parameters change slightly. Okay? So it means that the posterior distribution is in the same family as the prior distribution. Okay? And this effect is called conjugacy. And so basically, conjugacy is a property of pairs of prior distributions and likelihoods. Okay, so a pair of prior distributions and likelihood functions is called conjugate if the posterior distribution, after applying Bayes' rule with the corresponding prior and likelihood, remains in the same family as the prior. Right, the same family meaning just the parameters change, not the shape generally changes, right? Just the not the function family changes, only the parameter changes, right? And so this beta distribution is such an example, right? So it's conjugate to the binomial likelihood, right, or Bernoulli likelihood, right? If you observe heads or tails once, right, or actually n plus times and n minus times, right, heads and tails, then the posterior distribution is still a beta distribution with those parameters, as we had worked out on the previous slide. So what does this mean concretely? So it basically means that we can interpret these hyperparameters alpha plus and alpha minus as pseudo counts. Right? We can sort of assume that these are kind of hallucinated observations of coin flips. Right? It's sort of like in our past life, right, we threw a bunch of coins, right? And we've observed that they typically, roughly equally often, come up as heads and tails. Right? And then if this sort of the prior comes from our experiences from a past life, then this beta distribution models exactly this effect. Right? It's sort of like I imagine this experiment where I flipped this coin a whole bunch of times, and I just remembered how often it came up heads and tails, and I'll use this as my prior distribution. Okay? And if alpha plus and alpha minus are very small, I had a very short previous life, right? And alpha plus and alpha minus, if they're very large, then I'm pretty confident based on what I've seen in the past. I have a pretty peak prior. Okay? And so here's also what happens now. You can ask under, so this is now a full distribution, right? So not just get a single point, theta hat, but a whole distribution over theta. But you can still ask, now let me try to convert this into a single parameter, theta, right? And one way to do it is to look at the map, the mode of that posterior distribution. And that's given by this formula here. Okay, so this formula in the bottom of the slide basically says, if I want to ask what's the most likely theta a posteriori, taking into account my prior, right? Then that is, again, given by the simple closed-form formula, right? And it's basically a relative frequency. The only difference is that I correct for my past life, right? I add these hallucinated coin flips, right? I added these additional observations, right, that are captured by my pseudo counts. Right? You just increased the number of coin flips by some amount. Okay? And remember, this map parameter was basically what we had replaced our maximum likelihood estimate with when doing, say, ridge regression. Right? We said, we derived a couple lectures ago, that ridge regression is just least squares regression, right? But in addition, being Bayesian about the parameters, and basically assuming a Gaussian prior over the parameters. That's the same thing here, exact same effect, right? But instead of putting a Gaussian prior on the parameters, we now put the beta prior over the parameters. Okay, and so this is two examples. So the Gaussian is conjugate to the Gaussian. That's what we've seen and made use of, for example, in the context of ridge regression. Right, you saw that was sort of one of the reasons why we got the nice closed-form solution, for example, for ridge regression for the parameters. Comes out of conjugacy. But there's many other examples, right? So, for example, we looked at concretely the beta distribution, right? Beta is conjugate to the Bernoulli or the binomial. Binomial is just multiple flips of the Bernoulli. Dirichlet distribution, so we said not just, so Bernoulli is just binary, right? Heads or tails. Now we can say what happens if you roll a dice, right? We have a categorical distribution over more than two states. And we can ask what's the natural conjugate prior distribution, and that's the Dirichlet distribution. Very similar to the beta distribution, it's a natural generalization of the beta distribution. So it specializes to beta in the case of two states. And inference in that distribution works exactly the same way. So we're now going to have pseudo counts, right? Hallucinated observations from throwing the dice in our past life. Right? So now we have alpha, whatever, 1 through 6, right? Of all our C states in general, of how often we observe that outcome. Okay? And now note that alpha doesn't necessarily have to be integral, right? It doesn't have to be a discrete number, right? So you might as well have observed half of a throw. Right, so in terms of these formulas, things still work. Okay, and so basically, these are very natural regularizers. And they have almost no computational cost, right? We basically just need to keep track of these observations, right? And instead of looking at relative frequencies, we have sort of slightly biased relative frequencies, right? We take into account these pseudo counts. Okay, but that's really the only difference that that happens here. Okay? And of course, the question is, well, so where do our alpha and beta come from, right? Concretely, right? So what's, right? How should we estimate them as well, right? But I mean, these are regularization parameters, right? So you can use our standard answer, right, on how to estimate regularization parameters, namely cross-validation, right? So that's the usual answer, right? Now, you can be a bit more careful here, right? If you go this Bayesian modeling route, as I had mentioned a few lectures ago, in the Bayesian setup, instead of getting its point estimate, you can actually also integrate out parameters, and there's different approaches towards model selection that come out of this Bayesian framework, for example, looking at evidence of our data, etc. We have not discussed this in this course. But that's sort of, we talked very briefly on one slide about outlook towards Bayesian reasoning, and this is what happens here. Okay? But in practice, right, what you would do is you would basically cross-validate, right? So what you might do is you might just say, my alpha actually just depends, right? Maybe I just use a constant value of alpha, right? And then it gives me one knob that I can turn, and I can cross-validate it over. Right? So how many alpha parameters of these pseudo counts would you have in general? Say, if you wanted to fit a categorical naive Bayes model, what do you think? So how many such hyperparameters do you actually have? Well, so basically, for each feature, you have a different categorical distribution, and that depends on the class label, right? So for each class label, and for each feature, and for each outcome, right, you need to specify an alpha parameter, right, a pseudo count. So in principle, that's sort of a lot of hyperparameters that you'd have to tune, right? So in practice, you would just maybe set them all to a single constant and then tune that constant. Okay, so let's just quickly finish this, and then we'll take the break. So this summarizes our discussion for now for generative versus discriminative modeling. We'll get back to this later. Again, discriminative models model this just as conditional distribution of y given x. Do not try to model p of x. Right? That means you have no information about p of x, so you can't detect outliers, say. But they're typically more robust because they don't need to make assumptions about p of x. Right? In contrast, generative models model this joint distribution, which is strictly more ambitious, right? It contains all the information about P of Y given X, can extract from P of X and Y. So in some sense, more powerful, can be useful for detecting outliers, many other things too. But of course, you need to be careful about modeling, right? And that was the whole purpose of the discussion of today, right? And last lecture and so on, that you really now have to think about what modeling assumptions do I make about my data, right? That means you have to make a lot more assumptions than if you just model this conditional distribution of y given x, and a lot more assumptions can mean a lot more sources for problems, right? So it's a lot more challenging and can go wrong. Okay, that's basically a quick summary about the discriminative versus generative modeling. So you'll take the break now, and after the break, we'll start with basically how to generalize these ideas about probabilistic modeling, but from supervised learning to unsupervised learning. So let's do that after the break. Okay, so in this course, we started with supervised learning, right? And what we've done in the last couple lectures is we've given supervised learning this probabilistic interpretation, right? That led us to discriminative modeling, and now we also discussed generative modeling, right? As sort of a complementary perspective. But of course, we not just talked about supervised learning, we also talked about unsupervised learning. And what I want to do in the following is to now take the analog probabilistic approach towards unsupervised learning, okay? And that will have very strong connections to this generative modeling that we've discussed. Okay, and so the motivation here, and that's actually a primary motivation for why generative modeling can be very powerful is the ability to deal with missing data. So far we've talked about complete data, right? Which means that we're given a bunch of feature vectors, right? X1 through XD and the Y for our label, right? But in practice, our data might look like this, right? We might have a whole bunch of missing entries there. And you can think of reasons of why we might have missing data, missing labels. Plenty of examples. Certainly plenty of reasons. And maybe the data got lost somehow, right? Maybe we didn't collect it in the past, right? And only sort of for newer data points, we started to collect certain amounts of data, right? Maybe some measurements were just noisy and we couldn't make use of them, right? Maybe you think about medical applications. A feature is actually a medical test that we have to run. We don't want to subject all our patients to all medical tests, right? So certainly lots and lots of examples of why you might be in a situation like this, okay? Now, what does this have to do with generative modeling? Well, if you want to do discriminative modeling, right, you need to do P of Y given X, you need an X. Right? If you have missing data, you don't have an X. You have an incomplete X. Right? So that's at least a major barrier if you just want to straightforwardly apply the techniques we've discussed for discriminative modeling. Right? Versus if you actually model P of Y comma X, so you have a distribution over Y comma X, well, you could now try to make guesses, right? You could sort of try to fill in the blanks. That's sort of one of the primary high-level motivations of why generative modeling can actually be very powerful. Okay, so what does this have to do with unsupervised learning? So here's basically this, right? Unsupervised learning basically is this problem here, right? Where we have all the X's, but we don't have the Y's. So the data is missing in a very systematic manner, namely one of the columns is missing, right? Called the label. Right, that's what we've discussed whenever motivating unsupervised learning. It's basically sort of an unsupervised analog, right? So clustering was unsupervised classification, right? We accidentally missed the class label, right? Or dimension reduction was unsupervised regression, so we missed the coordinates on our subspace. Okay, right, so reasons for missing data, this is what we've discussed, right? Features might be difficult, expensive, impossible to acquire for various applications. Right, or unsupervised learning directly, so we have no labels. Okay, and what I want to do is I want to focus on this case, right, this missing labels case, which is basically unsupervised learning. But a lot of the ideas that we'll develop here, they'll show up again also if you talk about missing data, right, so in the cases before, so if some of the X's are missing. Okay, right, so that means we now just do unsupervised learning, so we might be given data that looks like this. Okay. Right? And now what we want to do is we want to say, let's take this probabilistic approach, right? So we now want to be able to say something about the probability of, say, a class label given only the inputs, right? So we only have the X's here. We want to give, say, a probability of our class label. Right, say model distribution of Y given X. Right, and how can we do this if we don't have any labels? That's the question, right? And one way to do this is to make some assumptions, right? So if you think about going back to clustering k-means and so on, right? We pursued here this model-based clustering approach, right? We sort of represented clusters somehow, right? In particular, we represented clusters just by their centroid, by their mean. Right, now, if you take this probabilistic modeling view, right, let's do this a bit more richly, right? Let's sort of think about making some assumptions on how, on the structure of our model, okay? And so the simplest way to do this, and that's most closely connected to our previous last lectures, is to essentially take this generative modeling point of view and make some assumptions on the likelihood, right, on our data given the label, right? So let's imagine a process that led to generating this data, right? We imagine that there's some generative model that would first generate the labels, right, of our digits, and then it would synthesize an image. Then, unfortunately, that process deleted the label, right? Withheld it from us. Right? So that's the additional complication, right? Before we said that we made this generative process assumption, right? So nature first decided on the class label, and then it decided on the picture, right? And it gave to us both the label and the picture, right? Now it's getting more complicated because nature took away the label. Okay, but you can still make the same kind of philosophical approach about how the data was being generated, right? You can say there is this generative model over y and x, right? Making some sort of modeling choices about, say, p of y and p of x given y, and then just somehow deal with the fact that someone forgot to give us the y. Okay, so you can basically view this as, say, let's try to train any of these models, like a Gaussian naive Bayes model or Gaussian Bayes classifier, in an unsupervised manner, right, without knowing the labels. Right? So it means we posit our model, right? We suppose our prior distribution is categorical, so each class is a given probability, and then we have a Gaussian distribution of the x's for each class y. Okay, and so we are left with a bunch of parameters, py, mu y, and sigma y, one per each class y. And now our job is to estimate all these parameters, but instead of given the full data of x and y's, we only given the x's. Right? That's the only difference. Otherwise, we're doing exactly the same that we had discussed before. So that's how we can view unsupervised learning. Right? We take the same generative modeling approach, we just now have this information limitation, right? Someone didn't tell us the labels. Okay. Good. And so now, let's do this here, right? So if we think about this generative modeling, this generative model, right, you have the categorical distribution over y, and say a Gaussian distribution over x given y, then this is a joint distribution over x and y, and we can ask what's the marginal distribution, right? We in fact had worked this out before, right? We get it by summing out y, right? So p of x, so the distribution we actually tried to model, right, that the distribution that we get to see, is just the sum over y of probability of x and y, which is the sum over y, we can factorize according probability of y, probability of x given y, right? And then this is just plugging in the different forms here, right? P sub y is the class weight, right? The prior probability of class y, and here we have a Gaussian evaluated at x with mean mu sub y and covariance sigma y. Right? So that's an explicit formula of p of x, right? It takes in all these model parameters of this posited Gaussian-based classifier, right? It just tells us what is now the distribution of the x's only, right? That's the only difference, right? And we can plot it, and that's called a Gaussian mixture. It's a convex combination of a bunch of Gaussian distributions. It's exactly this family, right? And this looks like this, right? So on the left-hand side, you have three Gaussians. And now these are general Gaussians, right, with non-spherical covariances, right? So arbitrary Gaussian-based classifiers, right? So their level sets for each of these Gaussian components is an ellipse, but the ellipse can be tilted in an arbitrary direction, capturing the dependence between the features, right? And this dependence can depend on the class, right? So it means you can model this sort of in this way here. And so each, it's basically the red set of ellipses are level sets of p of x given y equals red. The green one, right, are level sets of p of x given y equals green, and so on. Right? It's just the distribution over the inputs conditioned on each class separately and just overlaid on the same plot. Okay? And then we can look at the level sets of that resulting mixture distribution, which is here, right? So these are level sets of P of X, right, of this convex combination of Gaussian, right? And all these are interesting shapes here, right? This is no longer ellipsoidal. It's sort of ellipsoidal smushed together somehow. Right? So for example, okay, so if you take one Gaussian like this, right, with a small weight and another Gaussian with this large weight, right, then you might get as a mixture something like this green shape, right? And this here is the level sets of this thing, right? Just in 2D. So here, this is how they can look like in 3D. A bunch of points, right? The corresponding Gaussians and the resulting Gaussian mixture. Okay? Now, that's a particular model of X. Right? So before, we talked about simple models of X, which is a Gaussian distribution. Right? Now, this is a much more complex model of X, right? A mixture of Gaussians, right? And that captures multiple modes. Right? We can have, for each of the Gaussian components, we can have a different mode. Okay? And so this is an instance of more general family of modeling approaches called mixture modeling, right? Instead of Gaussian mixtures, we can in general have arbitrary mixtures, right? Where we would go ahead and model, have a particular component of our data. And in the end, if you want to use this for clustering later on, right, that's going to be a model of our cluster, right? And this given from a particular, typically parametric family, P of X given theta, right? So might be a Gaussian distribution where theta corresponds to the mean and covariance matrix, but this might be a categorical distribution, right, a product of categorical distributions, right, a categorical naive Bayes classifier or something like this, right? Where this is given by the corresponding biases, etc., right? Or it might be some other distribution. Okay? And then, basically, assuming that data is independent, we can write down the likelihood of the data, right? But we would now sum over each of these mixture components. So there's, say, k mixture components. For the n data points, right? And then all we're left is to do parameter estimation, right? Maximum likelihood estimation or map estimation, etc., right? But under this more complex family of models now, right? So now it's not just, say, maximum likelihood estimation for a simple Gaussian, but for a Gaussian mixture. Okay? Right? So it means we're now given data that, say, might look like this. And if you want to treat it as a Gaussian mixture, right, we have to specify how many components do we want to use, k, right? And then for each of these components, we have to estimate a weight, right? That's the class probability, the prior probability of being drawn from a particular cluster. We have the mean, right, the mode of that component. And we have the shape of the level sets, right, the covariance matrix. Right? And so we have one of these parameters per class. Right? So in total, we have our weights, k of them, right, that need to sum to one and a non-negative. And we'll have a mean vector for each class, k of them, and we have a covariance matrix, k of them, right, one per class. That fully specifies the model. And this just gives us the log likelihood. And now we can try to maximize it. Right? We can try to find the maximum likelihood estimate. Right? Now, the problem is that in contrast to doing maximum likelihood estimation for, say, Bernoulli distribution, the categorical distribution, or, say, the Gaussian distribution, right? That's sort of the example. So we've used maximum likelihood estimation a lot. Right there, the maximum likelihood estimation or map solution we could get in closed form. Right, it was very simple. Right, you just, for example, for categorical distributions, have to look at relative frequencies of each of the class labels. Right, that was super easy. Now the problem is this maximum likelihood estimation problem doesn't have a closed form solution. But that shouldn't be a worry to us, right? I mean, we've looked at lots of optimization problems throughout this course here, right, that didn't have closed form solutions. In fact, that was really the rare special cases that had closed form solutions, right? And so let's take an optimization point of view and try to use some sort of optimization algorithm to solve this problem. Right? right? So this, you can basically view this as a cost function, right? The cost function that now depends on our weights, that depends on our mean vectors, and depends on the covariance matrices. So a whole bunch of parameters. And we want to optimize over those to minimize this cost function, right? And at first sight, this cost function looks very similar to the kinds of cost functions you've seen many times throughout this course, right? It's a sum 1 per data point, right? Sum I equals 1 through n. And then we have some sort of loss here, right? So this is some sort of loss of xi, right? So this is all theta, right? That depends on theta. Right? So in principle, it's sort of like these optimization problems that you've seen all through this course. Okay? Now, one issue is that this optimization problem is non-convex, right? In contrast to, say, logistic regression, right? Logistic regression also was a cost function like this that came out of maximum likelihood estimation, but it was convex. This is non-convex in the parameters, okay? But, I mean, you've seen many non-convex optimization problems here in this course, right? And typically, somehow, things were okay, right? So that shouldn't maybe be so much of a problem, right? So you might say, well, let's just take this cost function and apply gradient descent to it, or stochastic gradient descent, right? And in principle, one could do this. There's one issue, though, here. Anyone can see a possible issue? So can we optimize over arbitrary thetas, over arbitrary sets of parameters? Well, the means are not really constrained, right? The mean vectors are really arbitrary mean vectors, right? They're just points in RD, by the centers of our components. They can go anywhere. Not a problem. The weights, there's some constraints, right? These weights actually need to sum to 1, right? They need to be non-negative. So we can't do arbitrary things with the weights. Okay? So there's some constraints here. What's even worse is the covariance matrices, right? So the thetas, I can't just arbitrarily parameterize, right? So the thetas, they have to be positive definite matrices. I have to be really careful about how to optimize over them. Okay, so that's gradient-based algorithms for optimizing over these kinds of cost functions, but they're more complicated. Right, if you just naively do gradient-based optimization on this and some naive parameterization, you might violate your constraints, right, and not get a valid model back. Okay, so that's the difference here, right? So it's not just a nice, simple, unconstrained global minimization problem like the one we've seen many times in the context of neural nets. But there's a bunch of constraints here that makes things a bit more nasty. Okay, so what we will do is we'll discuss, so this is this issues here, right? We talked about non-convex, it's not sort of a problem, right? You could still apply gradient descent, right? But we do need to maintain these constraints, right? The weight's non-negative, et cetera. And so what we will discuss instead is an alternative approach. And that is very related to the optimization algorithm that we've already seen for k-means. And as we'll see later, actually, it can be viewed as a strict generalization of what we've done for k-means. Okay, and a much larger family of approaches. Okay, so these are not explicit gradient-based algorithms, but optimization algorithms that are very well suited for these types of problems. Okay? Good. So how do we do it? So the idea is the following, right? So if you recall, we've said that we basically want to view unsupervised learning or clustering here through this lens of generative modeling, right? You make a modeling assumption about y and x jointly. right? So that means the genitive process that we hypothesize that we want to fit is of the form that for each data point we would first throw a dice, right, which tells us which class, which cluster the point is drawn from, say the color, right, red, green, or blue. So we throw the dice, we figured out we want to draw a blue point. So now we know that X must be drawn from a Gaussian distribution, right, with a given mean and covariance for this blue cluster, right? And we can sample from the Gaussian distribution. That's the process that we assume, right, generated the data. Okay? Now this is basically this exact same model as for the Gaussian-based classifier, right? Of course, and so we already have discussed how to train the Gaussian-based classifier. Right, how to do parameter estimation for the Gaussian-based classifier. It was really easy, right? Had a closed-form solution. Just look at relative frequencies of the class labels. That's going to give you the MLE for PY, right? The class prior probability. And then just look at those points from the class and compute the empirical mean and the empirical covariance matrix for the points in that cluster, right, in that class. So it means if we had complete data, right, if we knew the color of each point, right, if we know the class of each point, parameter estimation is trivial, it's closed form, it's really simple. Right, the only additional challenges we face now is that we don't observe the class label. It means we can't, at least not directly, use the algorithm for training a Gaussian-based classifier, okay? But if we somehow could get our hands on the labels, then we know how to do it, right? We know how to compute the MLE, right? Just some basic counting, right? Some simple algebra to get the globally optimal solution. Okay? And so somehow what we want to do is we want to make use of that fact. We want to use what we know on how to train a Gaussian-based classifier in order to deal with the setting even though we have missing data. Okay? And the way we're going to do this is in a way that's very similar to k-means. All right? So if we looked at the k-means algorithm, Lloyd's heuristic, remember, what we've done is we had all the points only. And now what we did is, for each of the points, we figured out which cluster does it belong to, which gives us this assignment, right, these latent variables that tells us for each point which cluster it belongs to. And now under that hard assignment of each point to a cluster, suddenly minimizing the k-means cost function is trivial, right? We can find the optimal solution, right, by just setting the cluster center to be the mean of the data points for a given cluster. Okay, now we want to generalize that idea. So what we're going to do is we're going to look at an algorithm that basically tries to mimic what we've discussed before. So we start with a guess of a model, so initialize somehow, and then we use it in order to classify all our points. And after classification, we do have class labels, right? And now, once we have class labels, we know how to train a Gaussian-based classifier, right, in closed form. That's going to be the strategy, right, at least as a first cut. Okay, so let's just work this out, right? So what we're going to do is for each, for each data point, we're going to predict, say, xi, right? We're going to predict zi indexed by t, so superscript t, so at the sort of the label at round t, as the argmax of p of z given xi, and the current model from the previous time step, theta t minus 1. What does this concretely mean? Well, this just means applying Bayes' rule, right? So argmax, this just applying the classification rule from the Gaussian Bayes classifier. We know how to do, right? So we maximize over a set of P set times the likelihood xi given mu set t minus 1 and sigma set t minus 1. Right? So this is just classification. In the Gaussian Bayes classifier with parameters theta t minus 1. Okay? So it means we figure out the class assignment, right? The cluster assignment given the current model. That's the same that we've done in k-means, right? So for each point, we just looked at what's the nearest point. Here it's a bit more complicated because we have to take the class prior into account, and we also have to take the shape of the cluster into account, right? That's the only difference. And now we have complete data, right? So now we have a data set T, right? That consists of x1 and set 1t all the way up to xn, set nt. Right? And now, well, that we have a labeled data set, we can just train a Gaussian Bayes classifier, right? We can get theta t as the argmax over theta of the probability of our data, right? Maximum likelihood estimation given theta, right? So this is train Gaussian Bayes classifier on dt in closed form. Right? So this is basically just applying what we learned last lecture. Right? So that's very simple. So each of these is very simple, right? So essentially the idea is we make this modeling assumption. Now with this modeling assumption, we're going to alternate hallucinating the missing data, right, by using the current model. And then we have a complete data set, and then use the fact that training the model on complete data is easy. That's basically the idea. Okay? So this algorithm is called the hard EM algorithm, in contrast to the soft EM algorithm, what's typically referred to, and we'll talk in the next lecture tomorrow. And so what is meant by the hard of hard EM is that we do a hard assignment of each data point to a cluster, right? That's similar to what we've done in k-means, right? For each point, we made a deterministic assignment, right? We said this point belongs to cluster 1, right? Or 7, or whatever, right? But to write a fixed hard assignment to one of these clusters. Okay, and that's what we do here. So this is just spelling out again what I had on the previous slide. Okay, so this is basically a first algorithm. And it's a recipe that in principle you can apply to a whole family of problems, right? So we've basically done this in k-means, and we work this out again, right, how this connects to k-means, maybe tomorrow. But this applies much more generally, right? Basically, this is a template that applies to any sort of situations where you have missing data, where you can infer the missing data given some model parameters, which basically just means classification here, but it can be applied much more generally, and where, in the case of complete data, it's easy to update model parameters. It turns out there's lots and lots of models that have this structure, right? Where once you have complete data, parameter estimation is easy. And where once you have the model, you can do efficient inference, right? You can, for example, find most likely class labels, etc. Okay, so it's very widely applicable, not just for Gaussian mixtures, right? For these types of distributions. Okay. Now, just one of the issues, and it's going to be the motivation for tomorrow. So what's the issue with this? So what you're doing here is you're making this hard assignment, right? You force each data point to choose, right? Each data point must declare which cluster it wants to belong to. Okay? And so why could that be a problem? Well, it can be a problem if two clusters overlap. If they really sit on top of each other, it might be very hard for a data point in the support of both of these clusters to choose, right? It might want to belong to both of these clusters. Okay, and that can lead to suboptimal solutions. And that really is the problem with this hard assignment. Right? So points are assigned a fixed label, even though the model is uncertain about the label. Right? And somehow this intuitively tries to extract too much information from a single point, and it can result to some repulsive behavior, right? That sort of you do get to artificially push away clusters, even though you shouldn't. That's an effect that we'll see later. Okay? And so I think this is now a good point to stop. So what we're going to do tomorrow is we're going to look at how to fix this issue, and we'll look at another variant of that algorithm called the SoftDM algorithm that avoids this issue, right, and captures the uncertainty about the class assignment. Okay, see you tomorrow.